I think there are so many calendars that I.
Pardon?
My everything's on very many calendars always, so it keeps
you
getting.
Can't fix it.
Okay, yeah, I always get reminders, you see. Reminders, reminders. Hi, Neil.
Hi, hi, Karl. How are you?
Good. I'm here with Tova, one of our daughters.
Hi.
The others are busy. And I'm here at Rambam in not the best background, but it's okay.
Yeah, me too. I had a whole studio set up, but it's with this complicated system called Riverside. And we just kept fooling around with the machines a lot. So Dana suggested we stick with, or Ruth suggested we stick with what's familiar. Yeah. So this is good.
Also, recording, as you know.
Great. Okay. So I'll start in. I'm going to do, at another time, I'll do a more formal introduction of myself and of you guys. You have a kind of a long, impressive bio, so that will probably take some time. Anyways, I looked, it was like over 300 articles. I'm thinking, okay, you've done a lot of work in this time. And you moved to Israel, and you had how many, 5 kids?
Tova.
Yeah, Tova, okay.
Yeah, there's 5 kids, and Linda, of course. She's, most of the credit goes to Linda, right? I did nothing. I just went to work. Used to go to work in Toronto. I go to work here. It's the same, all the same. Linda, my wife, is responsible for, the success of Aliyah, and our 5 kids also. They're married, and they all have families, and they all live in the Haifa area. Tova and her family lives the furthest away in the Carmel. All the rest live in the Krayot.
Wow, that's really, really close. So they must like you guys.
You can ask.
Yeah, we do. We like them, and we maybe even a little bit, too much sometimes.
Tova also likes her in-laws, so that's okay.
Yes,
they live in the Carmel, so that's good.
Wow. So I want to ask, what did you do right? What is it in the trajectory of your, you're a geneticist as well as a nephrologist, as well as a kidney specialist, and you're a pediatric geneticist. I've heard people speak about DNA as the book of life, that Elvis Costello says we write in it every day. And I guess he preempted epigenetics to say that, yeah, we actually do. Like when I was in high school, we learned that, once in 100,000 years, a cosmic ray comes and hits our DNA right on and we get a mutation. And now we understand that it's an actual living, evolving thing in real time. So,
yeah, I'll tell you a funny story. Another person you should speak to about Aliyah, but this is going way back. You may have already, probably one of Israel's most distinguished scientists who made Aliyah from New York is Chaim Sidar at the Hebrew University. He is the father, co-father with the late Aaron Razin, an Israeli. It's another good story of an American, Ole, graduate of MIT, MD from NYU, pairing up. He discovered epigenetics, he and Aaron Razin. And he once gave a talk showing that exercise can change, polish the DNA. It's called methylation. He discovered methylation, polish the DNA in a healthy way, okay? And that all it required, and then he showed in mice, that just one session of exercise could permanently change the methylation of key areas of DNA that render the mouse more healthy. So a person who's overweight in the audience put up his hand at the end and said, oh, does this mean I can go to the gym once and that's it? So Chaim tells this story. Chaim is the father of Yossi Sidar, the famous Israeli producer and director and so forth. So, I see our son Yossi's also joining us by, even though he's somewhere at Rambam, I guess. Hi, Yossi, if you're there. Here's Yossi.
Hi.
Anyway, so yes, Neil. So this is Neil, and you'll see also Rambam. I see you in your office, and Tova and I are here in my office. Okay.
Are you a geneticist also?
Yes, see, are you also a geneticist?
No, I'm a rabbi.
Okay. Well, that's kind of the question I had. I mean, I was talking about the trajectory, you know, that like we're like writing the book of life. Everybody's supposed to write their own Torah, their own, their own Bible. And in a sense, by what we expose ourselves to, and you just said by the exercise we do or don't do, we're writing and polishing our own story in an ongoing way. And I think as a rabbi, you would say probably that this is not, you know, just our story. It's the story of our whole people. And it's like I don't want to start with the rocks. I've lately been listening to podcasts about origin of life. And the latest thing seems to be, you know, that even like the crossover, the defining line between inanimate and animate, is sort of blurred, anyway, I don't want to get too involved, but I'll just tell you that little thing for a moment. So I say, wait a second, does that mean, you know, if rocks are alive, like they can make polymers of themselves and they can compete for electrons and stuff like that? And then like rocks are alive. So I thought, wait a second, like we refer to Hashem, to our God, as a rock. Har Sinai is a bunch of rocks. You know, the Mount Sinai is a bunch of rocks. The
stones behind Jacob's head competed with each other.
Right. There's several places where rocks as witnesses. And then I thought, I'm also a fan of mycophilia, of mushroom growers. And this fellow Paul Stamets, not a Jew, he, as far as he knows, although I'd be interested to hear the genetics of a lot of the non-Jews who probably are somewhere Jews. And he said, like plants and mushrooms in particular, since they're closest, they're closer to mammals than plants are, that there are ancestors and they have a lot to teach us. So this thing about rocks coming everywhere in our religion is strange and remarkable. And it makes me think like we're sort of like, are we, you know, I know rocks don't have DNA as far as we know yet, but definitely our book of life, our DNA is whether it's from rocks or whatever you want to start the DNA. I don't know when DNA first came into
the origin of life. It's a discipline. There was just a big international meeting less than a year ago, put together by Professor Tony Futterman from the Weizmann Institute, who is and Doron Lancet, who you may have heard of, is a geneticist and origin of life researcher. So Israel has quite a bit of research in origin of life. I happen to be that meeting, not because I study origin of life, because it also had a component called, you know, population genetics. There are many, of course, as you've read, if you're interested, there are lipid theories, RNA theories, clay theories, rock theories, all kinds of theories about how life and what is life and what is alive and what isn't alive and how it becomes alive, etc. So, but definitely you're right that clay, rocks, etc. there is a whole discipline related to their role in life. But it's dynamic, you're right. So what you learned about a cosmic ray hitting a piece of DNA and then causing one change and then waiting another 100,000 years for something else to happen is probably not what's going on. Genes jump from place to place. Tova's much more knowledgeable. They change their expression and they're very dynamically regulated. In the body and in the germline.
Yeah.
So it's right. Makes it interesting.
Yeah, yeah. And is that I know I'm also was a fan of Hertzweil, and he talks about methylation.
Yeah.
And I think gets, he's maybe on the obsessive side. I think he takes like hundreds of supplements every day and gets his blood transfused every couple of weeks. But more to the point about like you guys making Aliyah, and that's a trajectory. That's a, the word in Hebrew for exercise, imun, is cognate with the word for faith, for belief, you know, emunah, imun.
Not of that, you're right, emunah, imun.
So you guys exercised your options, so to speak, to make Aliyah, and that's, you know, in itself a remarkable thing. You know, I'm sure, you know, you could have, to say it straight, you could have earned, and your kids could earn, you know, multiples of your salaries are here. And I think a lot of the medical students who train here, that's one thing I brought up in our last short conversation. Yeah. I think a lot of the medical students who train here, at the expense of the government to a great extent, do head out, and they don't have to pay it back. So anyways, I don't want to get distracted about that, although I'd like to take that subject up at another time. So the question is, you know, what was it about where you came from, your parents, Karl, and you know, I can see the amount of influence, positive influence, that you've had on your own kids. Just keeping them close by is remarkable. Keeping them engaged in significant and interesting fields. You know, so something happened, when that began, like this kind of, you have a certain momentum, you should continue for many generations, but do you know when that momentum began? I mean, do you have a sense of that?
I can speak for myself, Neil. I think, you know, everyone of, you know, I didn't go to the spouses of our kids. They also have interesting stories, but I figured, you know, the family that made Aliyah as, adolescents. It's also not that common for a couple to move five kids at a very vulnerable kind of age. And adolescence is often considered a more challenging time. So the kids were 9 to 19, right? Yossi's the oldest. He was 19 when we made Aliyah, right?
18 and a half.
Okay. And Esti was 8 and a half. So, you know, most of them, all but Esti, were already in the teen years. That is, some people say, I don't know, Tova's a pediatrician and geneticist. Yossi has teenage kids. So he could say adolescence is often considered a self-limited disease, right? So adolescence, you know, it's something you have to, you go through and then you come out of it. About 1% of people stay adolescents for the rest of their life, but most people, you know, just remit spontaneously as long as they don't do any harm. So making Aliyah during adolescence. So I say the great credit goes to Linda and our kids, because they are the ones who had to undergo this very, quite dramatic transition. The transition for me personally was much less dramatic, because I spent, as I said, you know, it doesn't really matter the clinical department, pipettes, mice, cells and culture are not that different in Canada and in Israel. So I didn't really undergo that much of a change, other than maybe, you know, in terms of financially and things like that, and a few cultural aspects. The kids though, and Linda did. But let's go back to Canada. I would say the momentum began in Canada. And first of all, I want to say clearly that Canada, Toronto, our community in Toronto, again, and I think you should speak to each person separately if you have the time. Eventually you can, you know, book a time, and I'm sure everyone can give their own perspective, and everyone has a slightly different perspective, or even a very different perspective. But first of all, I want to say that Canada, the Jewish community we lived in, I grew up in the Sherwood Bathurst area. Our family were in both in Thornhill and in the Prue Avenue area. It was a strong, very strong, cohesive, supportive Jewish community that is not, and we did well, and we were, I think, in good shape as Canadian Jews, etc. But that being said, and you spoke about, let's say, go back to Linda's parents and my parents, you know, we also grew up in a religious Zionist. My parents were not, okay, and Linda's parents were not necessarily religious Zionists, but I grew up and I studied in, you know, Associated and Chat. Our kids studied in various schools in Toronto, whether they be Netivot and the Ulpana or Chaim, in the case of USC, or one of our daughters in Beis Yaakov, which is not particularly Zionist, but still, you know, Jewish values and the importance of mitzvot in Eretz Yisrael and the mitzvah living in Eretz Yisrael and the fact that mitzvot really can only be properly fulfilled in Eretz Yisrael and the mitzvah. In other words, I would say for me anyway, the main motivation was, you know, there are certainly machlokot about whether it's mandatory to live in Eretz Yisrael for a Jew. So, you know, there are differences of opinion. There's all kinds of things you can read about it. And far be it from me, maybe Yossi as a rabbi can say more about it. But no rabbi would deny that it isn't a strong, important mitzvah. No one, and you might say, a Jew can be a Jew outside of Israel, possibly, and certainly have circumstances where it's impossible to make aliyah for certain reasons. But if one can make aliyah, if it's possible, then it's certainly a huge, huge, huge mitzvah. And I would say that was for me personally, that was the main motivation. If I felt personally incomplete as a Jew, as good as things were, and as much as we were going to shul and going to minyanim and doing everything, I felt, you know, again, this is a harsh thing to say, hypocrisy, an element of hypocrisy. Like, you know, I'm putting on tefillin in Toronto or Boston or somewhere. What am I really doing, etc. The other is historical. My you know, parents are Holocaust survivors, you know, my father was liberated from Mauthausen. He lost a prior family. My mother was much younger, and she was in Auschwitz and liberated after a death march from Ravensbrück, after the death march from, etc. They went through the worst hell of the Holocaust that can be imagined. You know, if you read Primo Levi and this, you know, everything, it's all they went through the worst hell. And then, you know, set up a family. I'm an only child in Toronto. And basically I grew up with this. I grew up very much in under about the world, the potential for, you know, where we're as good as things are in many places. I always had this feeling that we're a guest. We're not really a guest in Canada. We're very welcome guests, very, very well-treated guests, extremely embraced, contributing a tremendous amount, but we're not really at home. We're in a wonderful hotel, in the Waldorf Astoria Hotel. You know, we need to be in a home which is maybe less luxurious, but it's completely ours. And if there's fighting and if, et cetera, and if there's difficulty and there's challenges, we're making decisions. They're contentious decisions, but they're decisions. I think, so there's the historic, there's the religious, primarily the social historical imperative I felt always. And I began to feel it at age 15. My first trip to Israel ever was when I was 15. And I remember very coming back from the first trip to Israel. I remember being at a bus stop. I remember this very vividly at Shepherd and on Bathurst, just south of Shepherd, waiting for a bus. And this sounds horrible. I think the kids have heard it. I felt, after being in Israel for the summer, part of the summer, I felt I was dead. I felt I'm not alive. I said, you know, I have no meaning here. I'm sitting at a bus stop waiting for a nice bus and a nice environment, everything like that. But everything's happening somewhere else. And I'm witnessing, I'm hearing about it. I'm reading about it. I'm learning it in school, but I'm not part of it. I didn't want to be an observer. I want to be a participant. This is before I met Linda. I met Linda just a few years later, my wife, and her background, also her family, our family was from Krakow area. Her family's from Hungary, also went, like a mixed marriage, according to my...
I'm in the same boat, yeah.
Okay.
A scandal, yeah. Hungary, Poland, yeah.
So, same kind of experiences in the past, although my parents and Linda's parents, you know, had no intention of making Aliyah whatsoever. They did eventually, after we did. They did. They followed us. But they did give us the educational background. And Linda and I met at a Hebrew-speaking summer camp, Camp Masad in Northern Ontario. We've been together for 51 years, and it was clear to both of us that we would one day make Aliyah. I won't go through, you know, we were in Boston, we did a lot. We actually, in 1981, when we left Boston in 1984, 81, 82, I met the Shaliach Aliyah. Kids were little then, not all of them were born yet, in Boston. And the Shaliach Aliyah, maybe this shouldn't be put on the record, told us, don't make Aliyah yet. Wait. Which I think, maybe he was right, but the Sochnut or whatever, I'm not sure that's the right answer for Shaliach Aliyah. He may have been right. Linda and I did a tour, looked at the possibility of making Aliyah in the early 80s, and then went back to Toronto instead from Boston. This is as we were finishing my training in Boston, went back to Toronto. A very important time period was when we did a Shabbaton in 91. We all landed Shabbaton at the Weizmann Institute from the University of Toronto. I was just appointed head of nephrology at the University of Toronto, and I took a Shabbaton just before starting that at the Weizmann Institute, where I kind of relearned some of the move more from physiology to genetics. And we landed on January 10th, 1991, and the Gulf War, you know, and the Saddam Hussein missiles started falling on, I believe, Friday night, January 14th or 15th, I think. Something. Pardon? Naomi's birthday, January 15th. So
we bought a cake mix on the plane to celebrate.
Yeah. So we spent the Gulf War in the heart of where the Scuds, no one knew what were on these Scuds, you know, and it had a big effect on us because we felt we were part of the history, a difficult history, a challenging history, a somewhat frightening history. But, you know, we said we're now part of it. We're not reading about it in the Toronto newspapers. We're actually here.
Experiencing it
and living through it. Now, many people thought we were and still think we're very irresponsible parents. You know, they would say to us, you know, what are you doing? You're taking your kids in harm's way. And that's an issue. And it's an issue even today when kids go to Sherwood Lumi in the Army and stuff like that.
You mentioned maybe that your parents came as well.
Yes. And I would say that a very, you know, interestingly, my parents did not just try to dissuade us. They did not even try. They knew we were too stubborn or single-minded. They did not say, come back, leave, return is too dangerous. Rather, my parents, who are not that young at the time, in their 70s, decided that they would just join us. They got on a plane and when they landed at Ben Gurion Airport, that's when Scud missiles fell at Green Airport. And well, I ran in, they wanted to put a gas mask on my father. He was already older. He'd already lived through, you know, the horrors. He said, no one's putting a gas mask on me. I'm sorry. You know, that's, you know, so, and they left him alone. I told the Avtacha person at Ben Gurion, you know, please leave my father alone. You're not helping him by putting a gas mask on him. He'd rather take the risk than he's already been through worse. So that whole stay in Israel, I think, consolidated a family, certainly Linda and myself, and the kids, I would say, each one will speak for themselves. There wasn't a uniform high level of enthusiasm, but everyone was agreeable, of course. Yossi was in a transition year anyway to do, you know, yeshiva in Israel. Everyone was a bit different, but I think everyone was on board. And I have to say, it's a blessing. It's not lo muvan meilav. It's not to be taken for granted that, you know, teenage kids who, you know, are rebellious are supposed to be rebellious. That's part of growing up. If you're a teenage kid who isn't rebellious, you know, have some level of rebelliousness. Bova snuck off and went skiing once. Is her big act. Everyone has a little act of rebellion as a kid, but they did. They moved to Israel and they adjusted, which is amazing to me. And I view it as a blessing. And certainly I had nothing to do with that. It's all them and Linda. I just stayed out of the way. That's the momentum.
Yeah. Yeah. I was just going to say that maybe the most, of all the smart things you've said so far, that may be the smartest thing. I learned that kind of late on. And my wife's also from Toronto, also from childhood survivors. And I'm also the product of a mixed marriage, Hungarian and Polish. But I only learned late on that, and I just was blind to it, that, you know, most of the arguments I conducted them with my wife were about child rearing. You know, also as Tova, as a pediatrician, and I realized like I'd never won a single argument, and that was like completely, completely a waste of energy and created so much bad faith. So anyway, it's just to say that the husband staying out of the way is a smart thing. The other, I just want to make some comments before I have too many comments to make. And that is that's kind of conventional wisdom. Don't bring your kids after the age of 8 or 10 or 11 because it's too difficult. Then the whole thing of difficulty of raising your kids with a sense of being able to confront or even welcoming difficulty. You know, the whole, this guy Huberman talks about podcasts from, he talks about dopaminizing difficulty, like welcoming difficulty and feeling inspired and challenged and engaged by it. So I think that's part of it. On the other hand, is the whole thing of the place of camps, and I mean summer camps.
Yes.
Also Shabbatons. I've seen, again and again, that people who were not raised in religious or even traditional homes, who went to Jewish summer camps, especially in Canada, it becomes like more than, you know, family of families, was a crucial experience in the sense of engagement in Jewish life. And then also, I've even seen that from time to time. This is a little bit strange, but if you think of people who accomplished remarkable things, like, you know, Steve Jobs and Jeff Bezos, none of them had, and Moshe Rabbeinu, Moses, none of them were raised with birth fathers. Not to mention Yishke, you know, who's like, that's kind of his tradition is,
right.
My father
heavenly
was
father, right. Yeah,
heavenly father. Yeah. So that whole sense of like the father is maybe somewhat absent or somewhat, holding back a bit or busy with something else, busy with making a living. And so I think the kid has to create his own, in a sense, to be his own, become his own father. And also the whole thing of difficulty. I know who's the guy in England that started Virgin Airways. The story is that he was subjected to, at the age of 5, his mother's like put him outside of the car and said, "You're walking home." And And, you know, some kids would say, you know, that's abuse and that's whatever, traumatic. But apparently for him also, another, you know, situation of, you know, the mother being the dominant thing, person in the family, and also difficulty. So those are kind of, I think, maybe twin themes. And then the other theme that you brought up, which is very significant, is the synchronicity, the coincidence, the timing happening together of personal and historic life. You know, so for me also, I had a situation. I visited when I was also 15, and we were at the hotel, and my father said that his father would have given his right arm to have been there. And that sense of, oh, this is something that's happening in real time, and either I'm in it or out of it. So that's if you notice my, it's like, what are people waiting for? You know, anyways, this isn't about me.
But the points you raise trigger a couple of issues I kind of think might be important. One is the process of making Aliyah. I noticed all along the way, I felt a little bit, again, lahavdil, and I don't want to sound at all pretentious, like I was being tested, because there were many reasons that we could have backed out. Had something to do with money, you know, something to do with Canadian taxes, something have to do with the fact that I'm a Kohen and I can't really, it's different if you're a Kohen and a physician in Canada versus in Israel. And it turns, you know, so I remember wondering and what answer I wanted, the faculty of medicine here in the Technion where I was, you know, and also the one in Bar-Ilan and Sfat, there are no cadavers in the building, right? Whereas others are. And I remember asking the dean who recruited me at the time, Peretz Levi. He said, no, don't worry about it. We, Kohanim, come into our building. We have no, you know, but these were all kind of things in the way that could have gotten in the way. And I remember as we were negotiating the Aliyah with, and I'll talk, I think I spoke to you about, you know, the models for we followed. I'm not sure it's the absolutely recommended one, but I, you know, being a believing person, during the process, I had a trip to Israel with Devorah. After Yossi, the next oldest of our kids is Devorah. She's a teacher, and worth speaking with. And she and I did a father-daughter bonding trip to Israel a few months before we moved. We moved in, I think in November, and we moved in August, so quite a few months before. And it was during this time that, you know, there were many reasons we could have backed out, kind of, for, you know. And I just want to make sure this isn't Yossi maybe looking to reach out. Pardon? Hold on. Is it Yossi trying to reach you? Because I noticed he just knocked off the line. Apologized to all. All of a sudden, desktop froze, started making noise, got a new tenure. Okay, so he's just apologizing that he's off. But you can speak to him after. He has his own interesting perspective and story. And Devorah and I, first of all, this was, you know, remember, this was the height of Oslo. And Devorah and I went to Jericho. We went to all kinds of places. And among other places, we went to Minharot HaKotel, okay? And we stood in the location under the Minharot HaKotel, which is said to be the closest to the Kodesh Kodeshim, where you stop, as you know, I'm sure you know this place, and you can stop for a few minutes and say a prayer where you're as close as possible to Kodesh Kodeshim without, you know, then people didn't, people didn't go up on the Temple Mount. Which of course Tova's family does regularly, but I do not. Anyway, so I remember stopping and say, what am I going to pray for? Okay, here I am in this important moment. Devorah was with me. And I said, you know what? I'm going to pray to Hashem that he give me the strength not to make Aliyah, not to let any of these impediments, and there were many, steer me off the course. And that was my prayer. That's all, nothing else. And then moved on. Because, you know, it's not a simple thing. On the other hand, Neil, it's not as hard as everybody thinks it is. I find, you know, it's people are people. There's this whole ethos that, everyone's taken advantage of. North Americans are exploited. Israelis are exploitive, et cetera. It doesn't work. It's a little exaggerated. And it's good to have these, war stories of I survived Aliyah, right? But it's not as difficult. And as I think I spoke to you in a previous conversation, I think, at least for us, I tell colleagues, especially in the medical field, get an anchor. You don't have to have an anchor which is even a tenth of the income that you have as specialist in ophthalmologist in Jersey, but you have to have some anchor in a decent setting, and then you can make a mechubad living in many professions, not just medicine. But you do have to have that anchor. And everyone is a little different, but I have noticed, I think, and I don't know if there's statistics and research on this. Another part of our aliyah was, I think I mentioned this in a previous conversation, failure is not an option. This is it. We have no, I could have gone, we could have gone back to Canada. They would have taken, I have my license. I could have gone back. But the mindset was, I'm not going back to do a little bit of, make a living in Canada part of the time or Boston. Everything has to work in Israel. There is no part-time, in my view, no part-time. Many of my colleagues follow a different path. They keep a major position. I'm not saying this is wrong, but wouldn't work for us. Keep a major position in North America mostly for revenue, and live much of the year in Israel, but spend quite a bit of time practicing their profession in North America. That also can work, but I would say in terms of, you talked about publications and impact, if you want to have an impact in Israel, my Israeli colleagues need to see me here all the time, totally invested, completely. And I think it's true of the kids too. I think, they didn't want to see your friends and the kids' friends and then marriage and et cetera. You're in or you're not in. You're not half in. And that's kind of how I think we conducted ourselves. We were all in. This is not, once you make Aliyah, it's over. You're not, there's no other option. And therefore, you have to succeed to the best, with Kadosh Baruch Hu's help, of course, B'siyata D'Shamayim. And that was the mindset. I don't know, maybe Tova thought of it differently.
It never crossed my mind for even a millisecond that we were ever going back.
Wow. Wow.
I didn't think that was part of the plan for a second.
That's something. Yeah, that's what I preach. Like I say, we once in a while we have a customer who says, well, we want to store, because I'm in the Aliyah shipping business, like we ship people's stuff. And they said, we want to store our stuff in New Jersey, and then we'll take a year and we'll see if the kids like it. It's like, okay. It's like, so I said, like, is that how you got married also? Like I'll keep a girlfriend on the side, a nice Hungarian girl, just in case, it doesn't work out with the Polish person. And that's what I said. But I remember when I was in basic training, it was Shlav Bet, it's meaning it was not like, it was like a month long of really challenging stuff, like remarkably challenging stuff, even at the age of whatever I was, 30 or something. And I remember thinking, listen, you know, don't worry, Neil, if this is too hard, you can just take a taxi to the airport and, you know, and go back. So I myself, and one of our local Canadian Rabbonim, you know, also came, you know, in like 1980 or something, and he took a couple of years off and head back. Now, I would also point out that things have changed. You know, one of my senses of a marker is, even though we don't have cable TV, it's when they have cable TV here. You know, it's like, you know, if you want, you can surround yourself in a very, I even recommend this to people. I say, you know, that like the crucial thing is creating or finding a community of similar minded people. And that provides a buffer. Everybody needs, you know, we're, you know, on this planet with this very thin atmosphere, everybody needs, you know, an atmosphere to breathe in and survive in. And, you know, there's no reason to expose yourself to, you know, if driving freaks you out, you know, you can get away without driving. It's probably even a better idea. And, you know, having a community, having a bubble, having, as you say, an anchor is very important. And just one other comment that I want to make, you know, you said when you were 15 and on the corner of Bathurst and what the other street was, that you felt dead. So one of the, you know, I mean, a common definition in our paradigm of death is where the soul is separate from the body, right? Like they say at, you know, Mount Sinai, that a lot of people, their souls left their bodies. And so it brings me around to the question of, like, there's a sense in which the land of Israel is a body, and especially when you go back to this thing of rocks and, you know, the wisdom of rocks and communicating that Moshe is supposed to talk to a rock, he's not supposed to hit it. It's like the humanity of rocks, the wisdom of rocks, is the sense that when we're not in the body, and the body is the land, that's a sort of death. Anyways, that's sort of you know, off the subject of Aliyah. But also my sister had the same kind of thing. One of my sisters went to the Aliyah Shaliach in the valley in California, in LA. And the guy said, what are you, crazy? Like, you're gonna leave the valley and you're gonna come. And she said, oh, okay. And she went home. So that's kind of the same similar model of people who want to convert to Judaism. Although that's a whole other discussion. My feeling is it should be easier these days. Is that they're supposed to make it very difficult, you know, to convert, because it's meant to be challenging. It's meant to be, you know, our name is Israel. It's struggling with God. Our name is not, you know, there's also a model of being a servant of God, but our name is not servant of God. Our name is one who struggles with God. Israel means struggle with God.
I maybe, you know, since Tova's here, I mean, you can speak to her separately. I can say that, you know, one thing, yes, he's off the line, but his class at Or Chaim, which is, you know, as you probably know, is a religious Zionist school, the counterpart of which is the Ulpana, which Tova went to. But Yossi's class, almost all are living in Israel now. It's one of the most successful Aliyah classes, I think, in the history of Toronto. I mean, so we have some kids from my chat class. But in Yossi's case, I think in a class of 20-something young men, I think all but one or something live and have their families in Israel, all but one or two. It's really, it's remarkable. And it'd be just interesting to try to understand what happened. I can tell you in my case, shlichim from Israel who taught me in chat were very influential. And that was when I saw a shaliach who had been at Sanhan and who could learn Torah and who could do this and could that. It had a huge, you know, I said, wow, I mean, that's the, and participating in, you know, what is momentous Jewish history, and rather than witnessing it and commenting on it from the side, you know, it was very important to me. Tova, your class also, there's some,
quite a few, William. I'm not sure.
Not quite like Yossi's.
But there are a high percent, I would think, then, of people who made Aliyah and have their families.
And you were, how old were you, Tova? 15?
I was going into the 11th grade, 15, 16.
15, 16. And, but you quickly made friends. In other words, the first, we did move into a totally Israeli neighborhood, okay? Totally Israeli. We did not move into Ranana or Modi'in or something. But Tova, you more or less didn't continue that much of your friendships in Canada and made brand new eight peer friends who found you to be interesting, because you were, you know, you did this crazy thing of moving from Prue Avenue in Toronto to, you know, some dinky place in Kiryat Shmuel, which no one ever heard of. So you made friends quickly, right? People were interested.
Yeah, but basically, truly were, you know, they were Israeli, completely Hebrew speaking, barely any English speaking. But I went from Ulpana Ot in Toronto to Ulpana Skula in Israel. So they dressed a little bit differently, but it was the same, a similar kind of mindset, a similar, Ashkafa. You know, religious girl school type of thing. It wasn't in that sense of, you know, girls are girls everywhere, you know, teenage girls are teenage girls. They weren't very different. The fashion was different. I didn't speak, I spoke Hebrew pretty well because I went to Hebrew day schools, but I didn't speak Hebrew slang well enough. But they were similar. I didn't find that they were.
But so they were. Different. But they were nice to you, right?
They were very nice to me. I didn't find them to be so different.
Well, that's an important point. And how important would you say is the language? Is that? I mean, I also want to get back to the thing about praying not to make aliyah. That's a really significant thing. But I first want to ask you guys about language. Nowadays, I think. People have much better English than they used to have, come Israelis. Would that have been a major hurdle? My son, we did the opposite kind of. The kids were born here and we raised them, the latest, last two kids. And we sent them to English-speaking preschool. And so when my son arrived at whatever it is, nursery school, he told everybody that he just made Aliyah from Canada. And that's why he didn't have Hebrew, because he was embarrassed to say that he didn't speak Hebrew. And I mean, there are people, there's a guy, Arnold, can't think of his last name right now, who founded Luz. Who never spoke Hebrew, Ova Shalom. And there are other people who founded businesses and who stayed here. I mean, my first 30 years here, my Hebrew was embarrassing. Anyways, it's not a deal breaker, but I also want to get to this point. I mean, first I want to reemphasize the point that moving to a similar, whether or not the language was exactly in line or not, moving to a similar headspace, people who were of a similar ilk, that's about community. And that's, community is, I think, significant. You know, they say exercise and community. I don't know which in the medical literature, which comes first these days, but they're pretty close. But I want to get back to what you said, Karl, about praying not to make Aliyah, which is you're in a good tradition of Moshe. Also, you know, chosen people, choose someone else. I'm really not cut out for this. And the prophets also saying, I'd really rather not do this. You know, this is not what I I'd like to have an easy life this lifetime. And anyways, so what was that about?
No, I was saying, you know, I knew that Aliyah was the right thing to do, right? It was clear to me. I'd heard and I studied the various rabbinical decisors about whether and heard, you know, whether not making Aliyah is a huge transgression, or is it just a positive mitzvah of very, 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 very high value? So that's the religious part. That's the historical part, and all the rest of it I mentioned to you. So the prayer I said there was not to let impediments block, because I could see in my mind that I was almost waiting for an impediment to make it impossible for me to make Aliyah, such as, you know, here I line up a position in the Faculty of Medicine, and then I didn't know what I wanted the dean, Peretz Levi, to tell me. Oh yeah, the place is just full of Jewish cadavers. You can't even step in the building. And then I say, okay, what a relief. Now I want to make Aliyah, but I can't. Or something else. I had an issue, I don't want to bore you with the details, but my position in Toronto was such that we had a tax year which ended January 31st. In order to defer a year's tax till your retirement, right? And I forgot about that. And then as we're making Aliyah and leaving, becoming non-residents of Canada, Revenue Canada sends me a bill for 11 months of tax owed, which was a huge amount of money, right? And I didn't have it. I did not have the money. So I spoke to the president of the Technion in person, an amazing person, Zev Tadmor. And he said, you know what? I said, I have this problem. I didn't anticipate it, you know? And I didn't know what I was expecting him to, wanting him to say. Therefore, okay, stay in Canada. He didn't say that, right? And he said, we will lend you the money. We will lend you that entire amount of money. You pay your tax and you come. And then he forgave the loan. So I want to say that this was when I was at the Kotel, at that place, I said, you know, please help me, Hashem, help me not fall prey to these many impediments to Aliyah that can come up and give me an excuse. That was the prayer, right? Because it would have been easy for one of these to say, you know, and often I hear people say, you know, I really want to make, I tried to make Aliyah, I did, it just, something got in the way. And you know what? I don't judge. First of all, I don't judge. Although I feel kind of, you know, sounds crazy. I feel sorry for people who don't make Aliyah, for Jews who don't make Aliyah. I can't, you know, terrible to say, but I feel sorry for them. I feel like, you know, they will have lived their lives, full lives, made contributions, been in very senior positions, Secretary of State, I don't know, all kinds of things, whatever. But in the end, they've missed what might be the most important mission and expectation of a Jew in this day and age when we have a state of Israel. Couldn't do it like your wife's, you couldn't do it. My grandfather couldn't do it. He may have wanted to pray. He couldn't do it. You know, now we can do it. We can do it. It may not be easy, but we can do it. If we can do it, we should do it. That's how, you know, do I judge some of the, you know, many of my colleagues, I have a good friend in, lived for many years in Dallas, Denver, you know, he says to me, I should do what you've done. I should make Aliyah. He's a nephrologist too. I should make Aliyah. I have no good excuse. And I'm I'm incomplete, and I feel terrible, and I can't live with myself, but I just can't do it. And you know what? And I say, you know what? Don't have to confess to me. I'm not, you know, we're not Catholics. I'm not a priest. I'm not a confessor. You do your best. You can't, you know, it requires a certain amount of strength, et cetera, and it's fine. You're fine. You're doing, as opposed to making excuses and saying, you know, I don't know, the political, I remember when we were already on our way, somebody saying, you know, I can't make Aliyah because I couldn't stand seeing cars on Shabbat on the roads. You know, I said, okay, fine. I didn't argue with the guy. I'd rather be in Canada and see cars of Goyim. I said, fine, okay. You know, so I don't judge, but there's no question that the either a historical, social, like a camp experience, like you said, or religious imperative are very, very important to push through the impediments pre-Aliyah and after Aliyah and over the years. Language, you know, again, if you come from a, you know, because there's more English and because English is the other language, we find that when I speak with a, you know, North American accent, still a heavy, heavy, heavy North American accent, Israelis answer me in English when I talk to them in Hebrew. You know, I speak to them in Hebrew and they say, I speaking in their broken English, they start talking to me in English. And that happens a lot. But it's at work, you know, I didn't go to Ulpan or anything. We landed on Thursday, August 24th, I think. And I started working on Sunday and as a department head, and I didn't go to Ulpan. I just used broken Hebrew, biblical Hebrew, ani chafetz. And the people in the department kind of smirked and stuff, and it just pushed through it and beit shimush instead of sherutim and all these things, and they thought it was cute, and they helped me.
Okay, so question, again, not to swell your head or anything, as much as it just deserves, but you accomplished. You have over 300 published books, articles, chapters, and I think probably most of those were done here. Here you did the, you know, everybody knows about the Cohen gene, and you've done stuff in genetics and in stem cell research and nephrology, and the list goes on and on. So my suspicion is, that a lot of the people who study here, because to get into medical school here, you have to be, not only a star, but it's, you know, like a star of stars. And I think you hopefully that situation is going to be remedied somewhat by opening up more medical schools. Like, you're the dean of the new medical school in Sfat. And I understand all the three medical schools that were designed for foreigners to come and study are now being incorporated within the body of the existing medical schools. So my question is, I imagine that it's not just money, that many doctors and other, you know, PhDs head for the US. And it's not just to triple the salary or whatever the multiple is these days. It's because they feel like the level of for their fellowships and postdoctorates and whatever might be superior. Maybe they're going to accomplish more. They'll become, you know, stars in that big pool, and they've done it. I mean, a lot of them are, you know, have remarkable positions in medicine and in science and every other field. So the question is, do they have to leave to get to do their fellowships, and do they have to stay? I mean, why, you know, I kind of came up with a carrot and a stick thing about, you know, when in the Innovation Authority, when you get money, when Waze got money to develop their program here, there's a penalty that they have to pay back like six times as much if they bring the intellectual property outside. And Yeah, and I'm sort of feeling like maybe they should do that for, you know, medical students, because they're getting a highly subsidized education at a top level, and then they're heading off. I mean, it's good for Israel's reputation. It's good for the state of science in the world. So the questions are, again, you know, do they have to make Aliyah to do their fellowships and doctorates, and do they have to stay?
Yeah. So there are a couple aspects. It's a good, very good question, I would say, and maybe I'm sure Tova has some perspectives on it. Do you want to go first, or do I mean, no? So, first of all, you know, you point out some of the accomplishments I've been privileged to have, and a lot of it has to do with the fact that it doesn't have to do with tons of money. I've had good success in getting resources to support research, fortunately, through maybe there would have been more in Canada, I don't know, but the main asset in success in research and teaching is who you surround yourself with, right? Who's around you? Not, in other words, you have to surround yourself with people who are smarter than you. And if you always surround yourself with people that are less smart than you, then you will never be challenged. You never rise up. And, you know, again, I don't want to be, there are many smart Canadians, right? But the level of intellectual competitive drive is very high. And I surrounded myself, or I was surrounded by very, very smart and good people, and who I had to keep up with all the time, right? It wasn't quite like that in Canada. I have to say, maybe Tova doesn't remember as well, but my lab at Sick Kids and in the Toronto Jail were nice people. They were good people. There were some geniuses, okay, but many of them were, you know, comfortable, relaxed, intelligent, etc. Here, virtually everyone is, you know, is hungry and passionate about success in what they're doing, whether they're being the best teacher, getting promoted, getting this, you know, finding out, curious, whatever's driving them, and that. That is a more important formula, in my view, for career accomplishment than just, you know, having lots of financial resources and being surrounded by people who, you know, want to drink beer more than they other stuff. So now, as far as brain drain and stuff like that, I think for Israelis, a period of time abroad is expected, not uniform, but is expected. Most Israelis spend several years in a fellowship abroad and benefit from that. One, because it's expected. Two, because they are exposed to, you know, different perspectives. But the most important benefit is networking. In other words, those Israelis who've been, it's not that they're exposed to smarter people or, you know, you can get anything you want basically through, like we're communicating now. I publish and have collaborators I've never met in person, but I am close to, right? But once you've been at Hopkins for a few months, you're an Israeli and you've been at Hopkins for 3 or 4 years and you have personal friendships with the head of molecular biology there or something like that. Then later, that person sits on the editorial board or the promotions committee or the select, you know, and then that helps. That does help. There are Israelis. I will point, if Tova allows me, I'll point out one, Tova's husband, right, who is the head of a very accomplished molecular pathologist, head of a department at Ichilov, professor at Tel Aviv University. He's an Israeli who's managed to succeed without having all that networking connection and being abroad, but he is well known internationally just by virtue of his own. But many Israelis need that time. Now, do some of them get stuck abroad? Some of them get stuck. They get and they get sucked in. And there's a phenomenon I see, and I'm dealing with somebody right now who went to Northwestern for in Chicago for a few years, and he keeps adding a year. He said, well, I need another year because, you know, I'm publishing that, and I need another year. And then we laid down the law and said, that's it. Your position here is gone. You have until this date to come back. Otherwise, I don't know if we'll take you back. We're going to open it widely. And he's coming back, right? So you're right. You have to, because it's easy to, you know, 1 year is not enough. 2 years could be three. Once it gets past three, it becomes chronic. You become a chronic Israeli expatriate. That's for Israelis. For North Americans who have made Aliyah, and I have, you know, in the faculty at Bar Ilan and Azrieli, there's someone, you know, who's from San Francisco, et cetera, et cetera. I remember sitting in his promotion committee as the dean presenting him for tenure and promotion. And they said, well, he hasn't been on an overseas fellowship, you know.
Yeah,
said, right. Yeah, he was born and raised in San Francisco. He's a graduate of university there. Why does he have to do that? And it was crazy.
Wow. Oh, he is at UCSF?
Yeah.
That's like, you know, yeah, that's
the top. It's in the top five of the world. So you know, I said, what do you want him to go to, Nebraska for a year in order to say that he was in Nebraska? Is that what's good? You know, there's certainly departments and faculties in Israel, in all areas, not just talking about medicine, which are world-class. If you look at some of the departments of the Weizmann, they are, and others, and Tel Aviv, and the Technion, and, you know, they are, and I have to say, you know, obviously artificial intelligence and network science at Bar Ilan are ranked in the top five or eight in the world. So would you want to go to something that's ranked 30 because it's in Florida, or go laterally in Israel to and spend, you know? So I that's a constant question. And the brain drain, I don't know how strong it is now, comparatively. It was very strong in the past, and there certainly are very accomplished Israeli expatriates who stay, get stuck in North America. And some of them, because there is a shortage of positions in Israel to come back to. But now, with the increase in medical student acceptances, et cetera, and the broadening of the system, I think, and also restrictions that are in place in Canada, the United States, it's harder to get there. Immigration is much harder than it used to be. So I think we're going to be in better shape in retaining and recruiting, mm-hmm. I think.
So, okay. So yeah, a lot of what you said probably applies more to people who are at the level of doing coming and becoming professors or doing research.
Right.
So my question is, people who are not going to go into academia or medical research or scientific research, you know, practitioners.
Yes.
You know, because I'm sure it's different here. I don't really know how it works in America. Everybody here, all the doctors I've spoken to here, and this is maybe sounds unpleasant, but they say unsentimentally, and even doctors who are based in America, still based in America, they say that American medicine is really money-based. It's really like I asked, we went to a gastro the other month, and I said, like, I read or heard that, you know, like colonoscopies are not so fashionable in Japan and Northern Europe, where the level of medicine is supposedly excellent. And I said, like, why? And he says, it's money. They charge like $30,000, you know, a colonoscopy. So my question is, getting back to that, is does the same thing apply to practitioners? And then I'm going to ask a second question because I don't want to forget it. The question is about people who come, like I know that when somebody makes Aliyah, they get like their next degree paid for, whether it's a master's or a BA or a PhD. Does that also apply to medical school? I mean, medical school in any case is a fraction of the cost of medical school, you know, like what, probably less than a tenth or something of medical school in America. So the question is, does that apply to a medical school? And the other question is, do you to make up for, or kind of compensate in a way for closing down these medical schools that were in English, is there some sort of thing that maybe you'll welcome more Olim into the medical schools here, or is there a possibility, Bichlal?
That's great. Good questions. I won't, you know, as opposed to what it says in Pirkei Avot, I won't go into the same order of the questions you asked. Okay, I'll start with the closing of the American program. So let me just say a word about that. Not everyone agrees with me, but Tova taught American medical students at the Technion American Medical School called TEAMS, right? And Tel Aviv had the Sackler system, and Ben Gurion had the MSIH. They were closed because it was considered, well, the facts spoke for themselves. The graduates of those programs did not stay in Israel. Very few stayed in Israel. They went back and served the communities they came from or went to in North America. And it was, and even though they paid high tuition and brought money into the system, they did not add medical human resource into the system, practicing medical human resource into the system, but did use teaching. So, Tova taught these students, and they were probably positive. You're still teaching them because there's still some left. And they have a positive experience here, but they don't implement that on Israelis. So because of the need to expand the pool of Israelis who are studying in Israel, those programs were shut down. Now, as far as getting accepted, so now who's expanding? Well, there are plenty of Israelis born and raised in Israel who want to study medicine in Israel and don't get in and go to Europe, and then some stay, but many come back. But it's you know, so all the schools are expanding. The Bar-Ilan Faculty of Medicine just got an approval to open a 6-year program, and so there's a 6-year program, a 4-year program, a 3-year program, with funding for it. So and all the schools, so there'll be more enrollees and more graduates and many more. They're expanding greatly. Does Israel have the capacity to teach all those students? The answer is, I think, yes. Will Olim, so this comes up a lot. We have, especially from France, a few times we had people coming from France saying, how come I can't get in? I got a baccalaureate here, I'm this and that. The Israeli system isn't well-tuned to understanding what, can I give an example from Tova got a very high S, she got accepted to Tel Aviv University Medical School and started there. Then she transferred to the Technion.
Tel Aviv.
Okay. Yeah, she went to Tel Aviv for the first few years. Then she met her husband, who was studying the Technion, or was in the army or something. I don't know. Then she transferred to the Technion. But she had, you know, she had a very high SAT score. But the Israeli acceptance system said SAT. That's, you know, we don't really respect the SAT. We're making you do a psychometric. So she did the psychometric, got a high score in the psychometric, but the Israeli system didn't understand how to deal with North American credentials as much as, and that's still a problem. Credentialing. Now, let's go to the physician, the practitioner in North America. The practitioner in North America wants to practice medicine in Israel, doesn't want to be a professor at Tel Aviv University or Ben Gurion University, wants to practice medicine. Is practicing medicine right now in New Jersey or, you know, in Boca Raton, and wants to, and is an ear, nose, and throat specialist and wants to practice medicine in Israel. Well, the credentialing part is not that difficult. It's much easier, by the way, than the reverse. An Israeli who wants to practice in Toronto or, you know, has a very hard time. They don't really, they're very gilded systems. So it's not getting so hard to get credentialed if you're from a North American school and have specialty certification and so forth. But you do have to have I think it's still the case. You have to have a tudat zehut, right? You can't you know, be a visiting, you know, pretend, or you can come for 2 months for, I don't know, but you have to, you know, fill out all the papers, and it's not that hard. And then the point is what position you're going to get. And what I tell my colleagues, and I think I told you in the previous conversation, is not to float around, not to say, I'm going to come, I'll do a little work in this clinic, but rather, and this is, I go back to the anchor, you become in the machoz, in a certain region, you're the consultant for ear, nose, and pediatric ear, nose, and throat. Practice in this area. The reimbursement is low. But that's your anchor. And then you do well. You become known. You're North American trained. Israelis kind of like that. And you're nice to the patients. And then you start, you know, building up. The different kupot start asking you to come and join them. They want you because they want more of their patients. And you can do very well, actually. You don't make $850,000 a year or whatever they make in you know, a top-notch ear, nose, and throat specialist in New York, who also pays rent, you know, pays, you know, basically, you know, they can't afford to send their kids to day schools there. So I don't know what, you know, it kind of washes out. But Israeli specialists in practice who've built up their practice properly in the way I've mentioned, who have an anchor, they know they're listed in Maccabi as the, and their picture is there as the ear, nose, and throat specialist in the Hadera region or something like that, then they will get clientele, and then they'll have another, you know, evening practice here and this and that, all in the same region. They don't have to travel all around the country, and they can do very well. And I the trouble the hospitals have is keeping them, because they do so well in their ambulatory practice, they run away from the hospital 2 p.m. to make money. And I don't know, Tova, your friends, most of your friends have mirpaot in the afternoon and evening.
Yeah.
And they work hard, yeah. but their revenues are very high. Is that not true? Relatively speaking, compared to, you know, it's high, isn't it?
I think so. I don't think they make as much as their North. I don't know.
They don't make nearly as much as a North American equivalent. But they also, I must say, people are very angry sometimes at the regulatory nature of the HMOs in Israel. But they do prevent what you just described, you know,
yeah.
Ordering yeah. MRIs to make money,
yeah.
Ordering procedures to make money. That happens much less in Israel. Cesarean section levels are low. There's less litigation, and cesarean section levels are lower. They're not as low. Maybe they should be, but they're much lower than North America, where you have a lot of medical legal protective medicine, and you have a lot of finance driven medicine, a lot of it. And if you look at Israel's health indices, Israel spends 7.something% of its GDP on health, which is laughable, but has health indices which are like 9th in the world or 10th or something like that. Canada and the United States are you know, spend, United States 15%, I don't know, 12%, and have worse indices. So I think one can practice good medicine and one can make a living. It's that olim, and I speak to the nefesh benefesh colleagues about this, nefesh benefesh, and I tell them, you know, I think you're giving poor advice to potential olim. You're telling them to make their money in North America, join, you know, do that. I think, you know, they just have to set everything up here.
That's right. I think you're right about that, because as soon as you make money in America, first of all, if you go to medical school in America and graduate school and get a PhD in America, you start owing, you know,
minus $400,000 off the bat.
That's one thing. And and also you get addicted to all the dopamine, you know, the easy dopamine rushes, you know, of a nice car and a nice this and a nice that. You know, I mean, you can have great cars here too, of course, but I'm saying you get addicted to those certain, you know, like dopaminergic, you know, things. But I have a couple of things. First of all, I might have mentioned about, you know, that there's a greater sense of integrity here because it's not so money run. Only thing that I've bumped into in a couple of places, including my son has a chronic kidney thing, and they wanted to do a biopsy, and I looked it up and I said, like, what are the chances you're going to change his treatment depending on the results of his biopsy? And they said kimat FC, almost nothing. And I'm like, why would you want to do a biopsy? And then I ran into a similar kind of thing, like somebody in the family had some gastro issues, and they went away as soon as they gave her a relaxin or something. And the doctors were insistent, like, that she had to do, they wanted to do diagnostic surgery. Like, you know, and I was like, really? You know, really? And so I asked some American, you know, docs about that. And they said, no, they didn't believe it. Like, that couldn't happen here. And then it happened again. You know, I had a colonoscopy and there was, oh, there's a red dot, and, you know, probably from taking aspirin at night or something. And we want to take out your cecum and some of your ascending colon. I'm like, buddy, you know, I didn't get too angry.
Yeah, but,
you know,
medicine all over the world.
Yeah.
Including in Canada and everywhere. I people call me from all over the place from Brazil, from Canada, from this, for advice, right? And what you're describing is part and parcel of variability in thoughtfulness and medical practice everywhere. I'm not sure it's that different here, there, or anywhere. I can tell you, at least my impression, worldwide, I think, but I see it very strongly in Israel because I see more going on here, is that evidence-based medicine, thoughtful medicine, asking the same question, what difference is it going to make to the patient in the end, not how curious I am, etc., is getting better and better and better, not worse and worse and worse in Israeli medical education. I don't know, Tova, you teach medical students as well quite a bit. Do you feel that it's different now than when you were studying medicine, that the idea of, you know, what's good for the patient and what's good for the family is more?
Yeah, even more so, and it might be coming from the fact that also families and parents and patients are far more informed and look things up, and you have to be more prepared, and they take a bigger part in decision making than they might have in the past.
Yeah, the patronizing, the idea of patronizing and I know better, and stuff like that. There's a democratization of medical knowledge, and I welcome it, and we're taught to welcome it. Patients, I want my diabetic patient to know more about diabetes than I do, right? I want them to come in and say, you know what, if you know, there's this new version of insulin. Is it good for me? I said, right. You know, instead of being embarrassed and saying, I don't know what you're talking about, blah, blah, blah. You know, I say, really, can you show this to me? Let me learn about it. And let's talk about it. You know, that attitude is, which was anathema in the past. Well, I don't, how can that be? You know, is now perfect. And
it's more acceptable.
People are less threatened. Physicians are less threatened. by the knowledge of their colleagues or their patients or the family members, as long as it's not hostile, right? If you're coming because it's just to remove hostility and then we're fine. There are cultural aspects, you know, they're different in Israel, of course, and like every country, but other different cultural views of what, let's say I'll take one example, you know, I have to ask my rabbi if I should take this pill, that type of thing, right? That's a certain cultural thing. A wise rabbi will say, look, I'm a rabbi, you should do, you know, find, get a good doctor and make sure. And there can be in different cultures, you know, in different communities, depending where people came from. Some communities are still extremely patronizing, patriarchal, and say, you know, the doctor's right, the teacher is right, everything, you know, you cannot question authority. And then others are, you must always question authority, you know. So I see the entire spectrum, and I think good medical educators make sure the students can handle that entire spectrum without, you know, getting angry, without getting hostile, and doing what's ultimately best for the patient. Ultimately, we're here to serve the best interest of the patient. But I think medical education worldwide is changing very, very much, use of artificial intelligence and.
Right, that's good. So I just, a couple of more questions, and then I'll, we'll wrap it up. And then we can schedule others for your other kids and other subjects if you like. You mentioned a shortage of tekken, right? I heard that word, or you didn't say it, but positions. Now, are you referring to academic research positions or practitioner positions?
No, there's a huge shortage, which, in my view, like, is a high priority for the Treasury and the Ministry of Health. And that is, it begins, we're going to graduate all these physicians. You know, they're going to, you know, over the next 10 years, the number of annual graduates will more than double. They have to specialize. There have to be residency training positions, and then there's plenty of need in the community, right? There's all these physicians will be needed by patients, but are there positions to train them into becoming family medicine specialists? Because in Israel, you know, family medicine is a very serious specialty. It's a 4-year specialty. It's more than Toronto. It's a 2-year, Canada's a 2-year, you know, or there's general practice. You could kind of just float or, you know, get a license and then do what you want. You have family medicine is a specialty. Internal medicine is a specialty, but there aren't enough slots for graduates to these specialties. There, let's say some of the less popular specialties you can get into, but specialties such as pediatrics, which is very popular, right? You reject applicants to pediatrics every year. Yeah. Good people, Israeli graduates, one, and they have to wait. And in the meantime, they float around. So when I say there's a shortage of those mostly training positions towards, and there isn't a good mapping. No one has taken I've talked to I'm very close to the decision makers at the level of management, not at the political level, in the Ministry of Health. And they were the first to admit, no one has done the work of mapping needs by specialty nationwide in different parts of the country. Wow. There's no shortage of every specialty in downtown Tel Aviv. In downtown Tel Aviv, near Ramat HaChayal and Rehov Barzel, there is a specialist for the right retina, there's a specialist for the left retina, for the left toe, for the right toe. There's 5.5 physicians per 1,000 people. In the Galil, there's 1.9 or 2.1 physicians per 1,000 people. You know, the OECD number is 3.2. So there's a discrepancy across the country in terms of health, and this is true of nurses too, of health professional human resource, and especially specialty based. That is driven by money, by the way. There, there's a money issue, because, you know, the ability to make lots of money in private practice in Israel, in downtown Tel Aviv, is much greater than it is in Tveria.
Yeah. What are the specialties that there's plenty of spaces for to do residencies?
Rehabilitation medicine, physical medicine, pathology, genetics. I don't know why, I just said most interesting. Where are there open? In some parts of the country, family medicine is wide open. In other parts, it's closed.
Specialties.
Which specialties are also wide open for training and positions? I have a list of them.
I think neonatology.
Yeah, neonatology. You can get into some of the more demanding ones. Intensive care. I don't know.
I'm not sure.
You could look at the number of applicants. The ones that are highly competitive are ophthalmology, orthopedics, ear, nose, and throat, you know, the usual.
Dermatology,
you know, radiology, et cetera. So,
yeah. Uh-huh. Okay. All right. Okay. So I'm going to, maybe just one last question. I'm a big fan of nutritional medicine, and kind of the classic thing that all the doctors who are into that in America say, oh, we didn't get any training in nutrition, and that's actually, and there's this incredible epidemic in America, and I guess it's a growing thing here of obesity and diabetes. Yeah. And so the question is there a push for that? Is it enough?
There's a push, but it's not happening enough. And diabesity is a challenge, but it's also different in different parts of the community. It's very prominent in the Arab-speaking community of the Galilee and part of the Negev. Wow. And that has both genetic and cultural components. It is also true in other communities, but perhaps a little less so, where there's more mindedness to health, exercise, fitness, lifestyle medicine. So-called, there's a branch of the Israel Medical Association called lifestyle medicine, which has a huge nutritional component. And I would say, one of the things we tried to do, and did actually, at the Faculty of Medicine in Sfat, is develop this program called the Galilee Diabetes Sphere. We got a $20 million donation from the Russell Berry Foundation in New Jersey, matched, and it's a $75 million program to change the lifestyle of the 1.8 million residents of the Galilee, half of whom are Arab-speaking. So that they are at less risk of obesity, diabetes, and its complications. That's a big part of what we're doing. And that needs to be broadened and changed. And so there's mindedness, and it's starting to happen. What's my fear? I have a slight fear. My fear is there are such good drugs now, to like Ozempic and others, that people are going to just say, you know what? We'll take a quick fix. Forget this exercising and nutrition stuff. I'm going to keep eating chocolate and watching TV and just shoot myself up with these drugs. The doctors are really smart. The research is really smart. I can take these drugs that make me urinate out glucose, and I can take this Ozempic stuff and I'll be fine. And I can still have my couch potato crappy lifestyle and eat potato chips.
Sign me up.
So lifestyle medicine. And we're very fortunate. We have the head of lifestyle medicine at the Israeli Faculty of Medicine, Dr. Lilach Maletsky. She was some kind of general in the army also. And she's really pushing hard to change to healthy lifestyles. So
Yeah, yeah. So that's what, like, Basil says, I never know how to pronounce his name. He says, you just sprinkle statins on your ice cream and your steaks, you know.
Kind of. He was heavily involved in clinical trials, of course. Did he teach you, Basil Lewis? Head of cardiology at Carmel for a while. No.
Oh, yes.
Yes, he did. Yeah. Anyway.
So, and then the last thing you mentioned, Arab, and we noticed, we went Hadassah to neurology and neurosurgery, and I think he's maybe the head of neurology there, and he's also some upcoming neurosurgeons are Arabs. You go to Hadassah, and a lot of the, you know, and went to Shari Sedek, and the head of the emergency room was there. So I just want to say that and say that a lot of this medical students seem, I don't know if there's affirmative action, like they're accelerated.
There isn't affirmative action.
Wasn't?
No, there's never been affirmative action. It couldn't happen in Israel. Maybe there should be, but it couldn't, especially in the Galilee. Our faculty has a very low number of Arab students, surprisingly, even though it's in the Galilee. And that has to do with, I don't want to get into judicial reform because it's a powder keg, right? But just think of this. If you favor a particular zip code or cultural background or gender even, or anything, the kid who didn't get in will take it all the way to the Supreme Court. And the medical schools and admission committees, and I've been very involved with them, are petrified about that, right? And they will not enable affirmative action. Now, does it happen surreptitiously in the selection committees because people have certain mindsets and want to, you know, fix past deviations? Maybe, but officially there isn't affirmative action. You're raising a point as to whether the number of Arab-speaking medical professionals is in medicine, nursing, pharmacy, is proportionate to the population or disproportionate to the population. Certainly in pharmacy and in nursing is disproportionate. In medicine, I'm not sure, but I think it's becoming disproportionate.
It depends on medical school also. Areas in the country that have larger populations.
But it will change. You know, remember, high tech sucked a lot of smart Jewish Israelis away from medicine. If that bubble bursts a little bit, they'll go back to medicine. And that's part of the picture. It's a complicated picture.
Yeah, I am aware of that. Yeah, so, okay. Good. Well, I really thank you tremendously. It was very enlightening and at many different levels in many different ways. So so let's continue this if you're open to it.
We can have another conversation, but I suggest in the meantime, you might want to speak to other family members as well, because they'll give you very interesting perspectives. You know, our youngest, Esti, was 8.5, right? So she is the most Israeli, I would say, although she still retains some North American hints, but her Hebrew, she speaks English with an Israeli accent, put it that way, okay? And Yossi is the oldest, is, closer to me. I mean, I speak a very North American, tainted Hebrew, yeah. And as I said, people answer me in English when I open my mouth in Hebrew. And it goes, you could draw a graph. Tova's right. Tova speaks Hebrew very well. But not as well as Esti.
Not as well as Esti. I speak Hebrew with a pretty good accent, but I throw in a lot of English words.
Yeah. Anyway, so Neil, thank you for your interest in us, and good luck in this project. And let's hope that we get a lot of Jews moving to Israel, and a lot of potential Jews become real Jews, because some, like you said, there's a lot of cryptic Jews out there in all parts of the world who should be allowed to become Geret Tzedek and are not. I agree with you. That's a whole other story. There's tens of millions of them.
Right. And as a, I'll just mention this one thing about, I heard many years ago from some geneticists about the Palestinian Arabs.
Yes, some.
Some. Anyways, we can talk about that. That's more of a controversial subject, which I'd like to address because we'll get some people in here who've like studied that.
Rafi Eitan came to see me with Sfimi Sinai, asking me to do DNA testing on several Arab communities, because if we can show that they're Jewish, then they'll stop being hostile to us. I said, look, they're hostile to each other. I'm not sure that's going to work. But there's no question that there are members of the Arab community who, were Jewish and who were forced to become Islamized. You could study that if you wanted to, but I'm not sure it's that going to be easy to do.
It's not going to change the whole demographic thing. Like, even if it does, might not make it. And all of South America and Spain and Portugal and everywhere.
Brazil has lots and lots of descendants of the conversos. Lots.
Okay. Good. Thanks so much.
Okay. Take care.
Send me a copy of the recording, okay?
Yeah. Okay. Good.
Great. Thanks, guys. See ya. Bye-bye.